Overcome. dream vision I'm hoping to be able to share with you guys in the near future about God's plan to move our church of God. But for today, I just want to kind of give you an update on what's going on with the kids. You've met with the little ones, and they have decided that they would like to be known as the Middleburg Church of God Believers. So our children's church has adopted a name, and they will be going forward in ministry under that title. Our teens have adopted the name of Task Force United, being a task force is assembled together for a purpose, and united being that our goal is to be united in Christ and to unite others with Christ. So our teens have a name as well. Our ladies adopted a name as well, which is the Gals, God's Appointed Loving Servants. So, Middleburg Church God Gals, there's a plan for us as well, ladies, so stay tuned for God's plan for all of that. For today, I'm asking that when you leave out in the foyer, there is a poll. Looks sort of like this. It's just a quick check-off boxes that I am trying to get a sense of feedback from our revival to cultivate our Christian walk for the teens. We're going to be doing a study about the revival and kind of going forward and branching off into that. God's got a plan for that. But I need your help. So I just need you to take a quick, it shouldn't take you more than a minute, maybe two, to fill out the revival poll. If you could just drop it in the red prayer box that we were using, it's now turned into a poll box. Just hold it up and toss it in there. If I could get everyone over the age of 20 to participate. The kids are not included in this. So if you're 20 or older, if you could just participate in that little poll, again, that will be used in the teen class for some of our lessons and some of our plans going forward with what God's wanting me to do with them. So I'd appreciate all of your help.
Well, once again, I didn't know we were singing to it like Wednesday.
Everybody sings the old ones, of course.
And I said, hey, there's something new, so we got 2 hours, and the last song we did, and 2 hours in this song. So that's just theme for us, just give us 2 hours.
But the name of the song is Confidence.
You're afraid to lose.
Yeah. Chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas, and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate said unto them, what shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, let him be crucified. That's what caused Peter to say in our text, but he denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you. Now, here in Matthew 27, here at Pilate's hall, this was not the world that was gathered there that day, but this was the religious crowd that gathered that day. This was the religious crowd that gathered, and they were given a choice by Pilate between Barabbas, which we know in what said there in Matthew 27, he was a notable prisoner. But Peter shines a little more light on it because he was there that day on who this Barabbas was, a murderer. So they had a choice between Barabbas, the murderer, and Jesus, and his resume speaks for itself. So here they had the Barabbas, the one that was a thug, the one that was a murderer, the one that was everything wrong in the world, and Jesus, which represented a healer, a deliverer, a miracle worker, everything that is right. And so they were the religious crowd that day at Pilate's hall was given the choice, and Pilate said, I can either release to you Barabbas, or I can release to you Jesus. In essence, what he's saying, I can deliver and release to you this murderer and everything that is represented in flesh, in sin, in filth, or I can release to you the spotless lamb. I can release to you the redeemer of all mankind. I can release to you what his wife said, this just man, the one that heaven declared that he is the Holy One of Israel. He's saying here in essence, I can deliver to you everything wrong or everything that was right. The religious crowd there that day had a choice. They could make a choice that day that could change the pivotal point of time. They could change everything in their choice, and with their choice, they was very distinct. No doubt there was some voices coming from that crowd saying Jesus. No doubt there was some there that day that was saying, oh, give us Jesus. But once the crowd began to cry out, there was that overbearing cry of give us Barabbas. Give us Barabbas was their profession. What were they crying out? Give us Barabbas. And what do I do with this Christ? And they said, let him be crucified. So when the religious crowd here in Matthew 27 had a choice between Barabbas and Jesus, they chose Barabbas. Well, that's very interesting, Pastor. That's very historic, and it had to be. And appreciate you informing that of us of that. But what does that mean to us today? What does that mean to us gathered here in 2019 in the church of today? Barabbas is long gone. He was released that day, and no doubt he murdered somebody else. We don't hear much about Barabbas, but no doubt he went back to his actions. We don't need anything of any remorse. We don't need anything of how he looked to Jesus and said, hey, thanks, dude, for taking my place. We don't see any of that unfold. So we don't know what became of Barabbas, but we do know what became of Jesus. We don't know what happened to Barabbas, but I guarantee you that this morning, if we, as Sister Rand is taking a poll of our results for revival for her Wednesday night class for the youth, we can take a poll here this morning, and every one of us, I believe, in this room today can say, they made the wrong choice. They chose the wrong one to be released. Time and time again, we would say that they should have chosen Jesus. Time and time again, we would say that they should have picked him. But we understand something, that he, Jesus, took Barabbas' place. Barabbas represented flesh. Barabbas represented everything in the carnal. Barabbas represents everything that is wrong in this world today. Barabbas represents every work of the flesh that is manifested. If they chose Barabbas, they wanted flesh. In the religious realm, they wanted everything that was wrong. They did not want Jesus. Why? Because they didn't believe that he was who he said he was. They didn't believe that he was the Messiah. Well, what does that mean to us? Well, there's two questions that Pilate asked. in this encounter that I feel is worth us looking at this morning. He asked this first question. He asked them this as he stood before them. Pilate said, "Whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you?" Whether of the twain will you have that I release unto you? And the crowd cried, "Barabbas." He asked them this question, "Which one do you want? Whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you?" Interpret it and put it in clear language is simply my message title this morning. Which do you want? He said, "Which one of these two men do you want me to release unto you?" Well, this was the question that he asked the crowd that day, and we know that they cried Barabbas. Well, the question is still the same. Over 2,000 years later, that question remains the same, and it stayed through the thread of time. It's still the question that has to be answered by every religious person. It has to be answered by every person that professes to be a Christian. That question has to be asked every day. Luke put it this way, that we're to take up our cross daily and follow Jesus. If we have to make a decision every day, every instance, there are circumstances and situations that arise in our lives. There's not a great crowd gathered there. We're not in Pilate's hall. There's not this great scene that you see unfolding here in this picture where Jesus is in chains and Barabbas is in chains and Pilate is standing in the middle of them. It's not a great crowd that's gathered in that decision, but many times it's just us. It's just us there in the midst of temptation. It's just us there in the midst of a choice. It's just us in the midst of making a choice between what is right and what is wrong. It's a choice between Barabbas and Jesus. It's a choice between flesh and spirit. No, the question that he asked the crowd that day was, "Which do you want? Which will I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus?" And they said, "We want Barabbas." The cry is still the same for the majority of the day. We want Barabbas. What does that mean, Pastor? It means the cry of many is, "I still want what the flesh wants. I still want that representation of flesh." We see here that he said, "Whether of the twain, which one do you want, flesh or spirit?" Now that question is being asked to the religious crowd, to the church today, to the Christians today. But I am asking you that question here at Middleburg Church of God this morning. And this is a question to you personally. But hold on before you answer. I don't ever want anybody to make an uneducated answer to a question. And I don't want anybody to ever, just out of a zealous attempt to be spiritual, to say, "Let me tell you." I'll say many of us today, if we put you on the spot, say, "Answer it right now." Because we're in church, and because of the setting, and because of those that are around us, and because of a need to be spiritual in a spiritual setting, we're going to cry out, "I say, give me Jesus." But do we really? Every instance, every situation, every circumstance. I told my Sunday school class this morning that geography does not change the atmosphere of who we are. What does that mean? That means that we should be the same here, there, and everywhere. A little bit of Dr. Seuss for you this morning. Here, there, and everywhere. No matter if I'm in the church house, or in the courthouse, or in the jailhouse, or in the White House, if I profess to be a child of God, and I'm a child of God in the church house, in my house, in your house, in everybody's house, in every neighborhood, in every walk of life, on the job, in the school, in the hallway, in Walmart, in Publix, in Winn-Dixie, no matter where I'm at, no matter where, if I'm in Florida, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, wherever you find me, geography does not change the atmosphere of who I am.
Amen.
What I am. But an attempt to be spiritual, and we look around of where we're at. Well, I'm in church. So I'm going to say, I pick Jesus. But the question is, do we really? So before you answer, I want you to consider some things found in the Word of God. First of all, in Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. Paul makes statement that we all need to grasp hold of, and more so than ever before. It's been said many times in our revival that the need there in Hebrews 11, I believe, and 25, that we need to begin to look and assess and, the importance of the house of God, assembling ourselves together, and what is said there as we see the day approaching. And Paul warned Timothy about the last days. He said, in the last days, perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of themselves, more than lovers of God. And we can begin to look, and we can begin to understand things that are unfolding around us in the spiritual realm, in the political realm, and just in day-to-day life. Signs of times are letting us know, but in case anybody's ever has forgotten, there is a word called rapture. And we still believe. So I'm going to tell you, well, rapture is not in the Bible. Well, it is speaking in the Bible of the great catching away, which is that's what rapture is interpreted to be. He said in Corinthians, he wrote this, that there'll be this great calling away, a great catching away of the saints. And less time than a split second will be changed from here to dead. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. And those that are alive and remain will be called up together to meet them in the air. And the signs of the time shows us. It's not about climate change. It's not that it's going to get so hot in 12 years that we can't stay here anymore. Or it's going to be so polluted in 12 years that we can't be here anymore. But it's going to be when the trumpet sounds and the born again is going to be gone. There'll be 7 years of tribulation. And then after that, there'll be the great white throne of judgment. And know that all of these things are going to take place. And we understand these things are played out. So it's very important that we hear the first three words that Paul writes and pins here in Galatians 6 and verse 7. Be not deceived. What does deceived mean? Brother wrote it here a couple weeks ago, trying to give us a definition of deceived. He said a man went fishing and he didn't catch anything. He had fished all day and did not catch anything, but he wanted to convince his wife that obviously that he was a better fisherman than what he was. So on his way home, he stopped by the fish market and he looked at the guy in the fish market. He said, throw me four or five of your best fish. And he said, he put emphasis on the throw them at me. He said, I want you to throw them at me so I can catch them. So when I get home, I can tell my wife that I caught these fish. There's no better definition of deception than that right there. Be not deceived. Don't have one perspective. Don't think one thing when there's something else that is totally true. Don't deceive and don't be deceived. He said, be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall to the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Well, what Paul is telling us here, there's benefits of choosing Jesus over the flesh. And we're just going to call it spirit and flesh this morning. We know that Jesus represents spirit and Barabbas represents flesh. And we know what John 10:10 says, don't we? The thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy. That's part A of the verse. Part B of the verse, and I didn't tell Sister Amy to put, didn't have this in my notes, we're going to put up there. But he said, part B of the verse, that I have come that they might have life, they might have it everlasting. So the question is, in this verse, in the first part of that verse, who is the thief? Well, we have to understand something about the works of the enemy, that we have as Christians, that we have. Of course, there is the world, and of course, we know there is the devil. We understand this, the world, and he said, come out from among the world, and come among the world and be separate, that the world is the enemy of the church, it's the enemy of spiritual things, the atmosphere, that the devil is the prince of the power of the air of the world, that worldly system, that worldly thought process, that world that says abortion's all right, that world that says all of these things are what we're supposed to embrace. It's all right for a man to marry a man and a woman to marry a woman and use whatever bathroom you want to. That's coming against the church more so than ever before. So that's an enemy of the child of God, is the world. And the other enemy is just the devil himself. The devil will come. He will send his imps just to come. He said he'll come in like a raging storm at times. He'll come in with fiery darts, the fiery darts of Satan. He'll bring all of these things against you. But there's a third enemy that many of us don't want to look at, but it's one his flesh. The thief. Do you know who the thief is in our life? The greatest danger in our lives is this body. Paul said this, who shall deliver me from this body of death? This flesh. Why? Because the flesh wants what the flesh wants. The flesh desires what the flesh desires. That's why we must be born again. That's why the flesh must be crucified. He said, be not deceived. God is not mocked. If you go after the flesh and do what the flesh wants, so before you make your choice this morning, before you give your answer this morning, know that there's consequences of choosing Barabbas. That crowd released a murderer into the streets. Not just any murderer. You would put him up there with the Jeffrey Dahmers. You would put him up there with the serial killers of our day and age. You'd put him up there with the Mansons of our time. You would put him up there with one that did not care to take any regard to anybody or anything. And they said, release him amongst us. Release him to have his way in the streets with our wives and our children and our families. They said, that's who we want. And we say, well, that's crazy. But yet, in the religious world today, I'm not just talking about out there in government, in the streets, in the branches of government, in the Supreme Court. I'm talking about within the religious system today. Many are saying, let the flesh do what the flesh wants to do. Let's be a seeker friendly. Hey, what makes you feel good? Because that's what I want to preach. Paul told Timothy, he said, be aware, son, there's coming a time and there'll be those with itching ears. What does that mean? Let me hear what they want to hear. And that's what I would tell them. Let me call Timothy this to preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reproving, rebuking, exhorting with all long-suffering. No matter what happens, no matter what comes and what goes, preach the word. Preach the word. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. Walk after the Spirit. Live after the Spirit. He said, for those that walk after, whatsoever man soweth shall he also reap, for he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. So what's he saying? If you choose Barabbas, you're going to suffer the effects of having Barabbas released. You have to understand that you've released a murderer. If I took a python or a cobra or a snake this morning and said, hey, let me give you this, or let me give you Jesus. Which one do you want released in your house? You want the things of Jesus? Now, when you receive Jesus, you have to receive all of his commands. Right. You have to receive the word rightly divided. You have to live by his rules, by his system. You have to live with a desire towards him. Or I could release all of these snakes into your house. You understand? We did not remove the venom from the snake. We did not take the strength away from the python. We did not take any of that. All of the effects is there, and it can be released unto you. Or you can have Jesus, and you can live, as my mom used to say, you live in my house, you live by my rules. But Jesus said, when you let me into your house, it becomes my house, and you live by my rules. Because we have been bought with a price. We're not our own. He said, I purchased you with a price. His blood was an expensive price at Calvary. And he paid that price for you and I. So in essence, we're saying, yes, you can have the flesh released unto you, but you're going to reap what you sow. He said, for he that soweth to the Spirit shall also reap life everlasting. One thing to consider. Let's consider something else that Paul wrote in Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 14. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit is the life, and Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sent in his own Son the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit mind the things of the Spirit. So when you ask for Barabbas, the flesh to be released to you, you've got to cater to the flesh. You've you've got to take care of? How many would let a murderer move into your house today and take care of them? A known, convicted sinner that is beat, that has done all of these things, you have to sleep with both eyes open. Because he is so filthy, so corrupt. There was no trial. There was no trial of his peers to say no. He was accused of that, but he's innocent. None of that. But he was guilty, but he said, I can release to you a notable prison. He said, but understand something, that after that, you've got to mind things up. But they that are out of the spirit, the things of the spirit, to be carnally minded is death, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. I don't have a pet snake, because I'm not playing with death. I don't have a pet python. Oh, it's good, it's okay, until the day it is not. So we understand something. There are those of you that may have it, that's your prerogative. But I don't. Spiritually, we can never have that. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. You're not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so, the spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he's none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by the spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we're not debtors. We're debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. If we live a life that always does what the flesh wants, we cannot be. We can say with our lips this morning, I choose Jesus. I choose Jesus. I choose Jesus. But if we live a life that always does what the flesh wants, we cannot. He said, you are none of his. We can profess all that we want to profess. We can proclaim all that we want to proclaim. We can have all the lip service that we want to. There may have been those in that crowd there that day that did not cry Barabbas. They may have said Jesus, but they embraced Barabbas when he came after a process of time. There is those of us who have made a commitment to Christ, and we say, well, I've made that decision. I've made my decision to follow Jesus. I've accepted him as my Lord and my Savior. I am washed in his blood. I have been cleansed from all my sins. But understand something. We're still left with a choice every day to make that choice of who will I choose to bring in and to embrace and to live and to be active in my life. Will it be the flesh or will it be the spirit? Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father. Who are we representing? Who are we representing? It's not about name tag or a t-shirt or a license plate or a hearsay or even what we voice. Actions speak louder than words. The actions of that crowd there that day was give us Barabbas. And we say, how could they do that? Have you been doing, question for you this morning, have you been doing what makes the flesh happy or what makes God happy? Have you been making those decisions that makes God happy in every step of the way? There's a statement that I saw that came across, and I agree with this. It says to do what makes you happy culture is so toxic to us as Christians. Do whatever you want to do. That's a toxic thing for a Christian to have. Whatever makes me happy is what I'm going to do. That's a culture that's entered in. And listen, we're not called to do what makes us happy. We're called to do what glorifies God. This Christian walk is not always sunshine and happiness. It's hard work. It's a battlefield. It's dedication to Him, not to ourselves. We must do what glorifies God. If we say, give me Jesus, Jesus, that we have to do what glorifies Him. We have to walk in the light as He is in the light. We've got to understand that it's not about our happiness. It's about our holiness. Without holiness, no man can see the Lord. But can I remind you that it is joy unspeakable and full of glory. We don't have to run after things that makes us happy. We don't have to look for things of this flesh to make us happy. Oh, I can know what the songwriter said. He hath made me glad. He knows how to supply all of my need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But yet we chase after this work of the flesh, this work of the flesh, that work of the flesh. Scripture tells us the works of the flesh are manifest. Everywhere, all around us, choices to be made. Every day we have a choice to make. Will I do what glorifies self, or will I do what glorifies God? Which of the two do you want? Do you want Jesus, or do you want flesh? Do you want what you want, or do you want what He wants? We have to make that choice when we get up and it's church time on Sunday morning. Do I want to do what the flesh wants to do, and that's hit snooze and go back to sleep, and when I do get up, go to the lake, to the beach, or anywhere else, or do I want to assemble myself in the house of God where I can draw strength from the things of God? And I just, like you said last Sunday, have to be a high day in Zion. You got to go there. You're expected over here. This is the expectation of your peers for you. This is what has to get done. We just spent a lot of time in revival church. We've just spent 19 days in a row. 19 days in a row we had an opportunity to be in a church service. Here are some outreach of this. Between a youth service, a Green Cove nursing home ministry, PYC 19, and I counted it up over the last up till Thursday night, 19 services, not bragging, but this is just the way it is. Over 19 days, 24 services that I was in. 24 church services. And you know how many times the flesh told me don't go in those 24 church services, Sister Gilda? Probably at least 27. The flesh will give you the pastor. He will give the pastor excuse and reason. Well, you really, you know, to some of those things, well, you're in revival at your church, and you're not really over the youth department, and you've got those. Let somebody else go to youth service.
Man.
Let somebody else go do the nursing home. Pastor can't do everything. That's what the flesh wants to say. But I didn't go to youth service because I had an obligation to be in youth service. I didn't go to nursing home because I had an obligation to be at nursing home. I didn't drive over to McLean. I'm not a member of McLean. But I didn't drive over there on Thursday and Friday morning for those services because I was obligated to Pastor Shannon Connor or anybody in his church to be there. But there was a spiritual man inside of me that has been reminded over and over in our revival. He that hungers and thirsts after righteousness shall be filled. Listen, church, He's still working on me. I'm still a work in process. And I can't keep feeding this flesh what the flesh wants. I've got to say, I want the Spirit. I want Jesus. And give me page 6 of the Red Back Bible. I want to know more about my Lord. I want to know more about Him. Give me the Spirit. Give me the things of the Spirit. We can't sing page 6 and then live out something out there in this world.
Come on.
We can't say with these lips, I want to know more about the Lord. But yet our approach is every opportunity that we're given to know more about the Lord, we're trying to learn something else about this. Or learn something else about that. Oh, Pastor's going to preach church attendance at the end of revival, because attendance for revival is down. That's my job. Number one. Number two, that's my calling.
That's right.
Number three, more than both of those, my passion.
Amen.
It's my passion. I don't want you here so I can check a number. But I want you here because I know that God speaks to me to give you what you need.
That's right.
To encourage you to go another mile. To encourage you, the flesh is going to try to deceive you. Be not deceived. If we're not gathered together under the Word of God, under the anointed Word of God, we will be drawn away by every wind of doctrine that blows.
Man.
Everything that comes our way will pull us away and draw us away and get our attention. So we've given that choice. Which do you choose? When we choose the flesh, choose flesh, we begin to push away the things of the Spirit. We have another question that we have to answer if we choose flesh. He said, what shall I do with then with Jesus, which is called Christ? What do they cry out? Let him be crucified. Crucify. He said, if you want Barabbas, what do I do with Jesus? They said, crucify him. So when we make that decision to do what we want to do, when we make that decision to do what the flesh wants and act like we're Burger King and get it our way, right? I want it. The national anthem of hell is sung, I did it my way. I believe that's the national anthem of hell myself. You can preach it any way you want to when you preach it, but I believe that. But that's what got you there. It's doing it your way.
Right.
So when we choose to do it our way, when we make that choice as Christians, as spiritual beings, as religious folks, as the ones that represent Christ, ambassadors of Christ in this world, and when we make a choice to do what the flesh wants to do rather than what God has dealt with our heart to do, and we said, like a three-year-old, I don't want to. Then there's something else that has to be done. And Pilate asked that question. Okay, you chose Barabbas. What do you want me to do with Jesus? Ask us this morning, when we pick the flesh over the Spirit, what do we do with Jesus? When we choose to go to the places that the Spirit of God is not going to dwell in, what do we do with Jesus? Do we think that we can walk into those places and do those things and say, Jesus, stay right here, I'll be back in a minute. Is that what we do? No, he said he's with us always. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us.
Amen.
But we have to understand something. We have to look back to the Old Testament. I know folks want to do away with the Old Testament, but you have to go back to the Old Testament and look at the Ark of the Covenant if we really find out what we're supposed to do with Jesus. And we find out when they did it the wrong way, it caused problems. The way that was supposed to be done, the Ark of the Covenant represented the Spirit of God, and when it was laid out and when everything, it had these rings that was placed on it that these poles would go through, and they would slide those poles through those rings. Why? So nobody could touch the Ark of the Covenant. But there was only the Levites that could touch it, those Levitical priests, that they would come and they would grab those poles and they would lift it up and they would shoulder the Ark of the Covenant, never touching the Ark of the Covenant, but only those poles, and they would tote it and it would be carried that way. That was how the Ark of the Covenant was supposed to be handled. Well, that was how it represented the Spirit of God. Well, it's told the same way when Jesus said this in Luke, take up your cross daily and follow Jesus. He's saying, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the same way. We've got to shoulder that burden and we have to carry that. But we find it came a time that David, the Philistines, had taken the Ark of the Covenant. Maybe you remember reading this as we read through the Bible here just a couple weeks ago. They wanted to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Israel where it belonged, put it in its rightful place. David didn't do his research. And the Philistines, how many of those Philistines represent the world, represent the devil, represent all the forces of evil? That's what they represent in the Old Testament. They build a new car because they don't care how they handle the Spirit of God. They don't care. The world does not care how they handle the things of God. They don't care about instruction. They don't care about detail. We've got a lot of people out there putting God in it and putting Jesus in it and handling God any way they want to. They'll use Him for promotion. They'll use Him for self-gain. They'll use Him to get elected. They'll use Him for anything. Hey, if it's better to be a Christian, sure. I am the Spirit of God that way. Yeah, I'm that. Whatever. They're chameleons. Whatever you want them to be, that's what they are. That's how they handle. That's how the Philistines did it. Said, just put that thing on the cart and let's go. Well, David went to bring the Ark of the Covenant back, and when he did, he didn't do some examination for one. I believe if I was there, I'd have said, what's those little rings for? What's the rings on the side of that thing for? What are those poles there laid beside it for? David just threw it on the cart. They pulled behind them. And when they did, cost a man his life. Because the cart went steady, he reached for it, he touched an innocent man and died there that day. Why? Because they handled the Ark of the Covenant wrong. When we, it's the same way as we bring that over into the New Testament, when we handle the things in the Spirit wrong, we do it our way. When we say, okay, I'm going to put the Spirit of God and Jesus on the cart behind me, and come on, Jesus. We got our, what was that red flag? What they call that?
Radio flyer.
Radio flyer. I used to put Coke bottles in my radio flyer, walking down the sidewalk. I remember taking a walk in a mile and a half to the gas station. Had my Coke bottles in there, pulling that red flag behind me. I was cashing them in. There was a pair of sunglasses that I wanted. Cash them in, bought those sunglasses. But you know what? I can't treat Jesus like I treated those Coke bottles. He can't be put in my radio flyer, red wagon. Come on, Jesus. Let me make sure he's still there. Come on. He's not our pet on a leash. He's not our little pet lamb. But he's the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world. And he said the way that we handle the Spirit of God is important. Jesus is not an add-on to our life. He's not a footnote on our resume. It's just not a feel better, do better. Hey, this is just another part. But as Sister Mary sung last week, I believe it was, to me, he's become everything. He's everything that I need. So what David had to do, he said, leave that thing alone. We've got to reassess and reevaluate. He studied it, and he said, put these poles through here and let everybody else back up. These Levitical men, they're going to come, they're going to take it, and they're going to carry it. And when they did, they came back into town. The Ark of the Covenant was with them, and it said that David danced before the Lord. They would provide, the church broke out. Why? Because they handled the Spirit of God, that the Ark of the Covenant, that they represented God in the right way. The only way that revival is going to break out, Brother Kevin, the only way that the Spirit of God is going to sweep through, the only thing that he's going to prove anything that we do is when we handle the Spirit of God and the things of God and the work of God. What do you want me to do with this Jesus? They try to crucify him. And in many of our actions, when we continue to choose the things of the flesh, we're crying the same thing. Brother Ron used to sing that song, I wonder if when I deny him, that he still feels the nails. When I do those things, does he still feel the nails? Does he still feel the stripes? We know that he does not, but that's a thing to wonder. That we're crucifying him afresh. Scripture talks about crucifying him afresh. But it calls him this morning. If we choose the flesh, understand something has to be done with Jesus. Because he's not going to be an Adam. He said, it's me and only me. All me. 100%. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto the Lord. To know that I'm all in. I'm all his. Choice we all have to make. Which do you choose? Which do you want? Joshua 24, verse 13 through 15. If Brother Mike, Brother Paul, the group would come this morning. And I have given you a land for which you did not labor, cities which you did not build, and you dwell in them, of the vineyards and olive yards which you planted, not do you eat. I was in a revival service here last week, and that verse was read. They were getting on to verse 15 for their message, for their text. But when they read that verse, I couldn't help but think about us here in these facilities that we have. I said, I've given you a land which you did not labor for. I'm so glad, Lord, that I didn't have to dig the footer for this building.
Come on. Amen.
I'm glad I didn't have to get out here in concrete boots and pour the slab, run the electric, build the wall. I'm a pastor, not a general contractor. I'm glad that I don't have to serve in that capacity. To put everything up on this campus that we have on this campus. That was our goal. We had property. What we want to do is we want to build a bigger church. God said, you know what? You don't have to build a bigger church. I'll bless you with a bigger child.
Amen.
He said, I'll give you a land that you did not labor. I'll give you a building, a city there that you did not build, that you could dwell in them. He said, I'll give you vineyards and altars that you did not plant. He said, I'm going to give you things that you didn't have to do. God said, this is just my blessings upon you. Then verse 14, it says this, now therefore, fear the Lord. We've got so much to fear the Lord for. We've got so much to thank Him for and praise Him for, how He's blessed us. He said, and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. It's time that we get down to business and serve Him. Let's be sincere. We can't be going through the motions. We can't be without any sincerity in our walk with God. Listen, are we saved? And we need to act like it. We need to be sincere. He said, serve Him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood in Egypt. And serve the Lord. This was a dying man, Joshua. He was in his dying moments. He had succeeded Moses. He was Moses' minister. We read in Scripture that when Moses was there in the presence of God, Joshua was there too. When Moses walked out from being there in the presence of the Lord, Scripture tells us Joshua was still there. Brother Elijah brought that out the other night. There's Joshua. Then when Moses went up the mountain, it was not Gershom, his son, that was halfway up the mountain. It was Joshua.
Right.
Everywhere the Spirit of God was moving, everything that God was doing, close by was Joshua. As Moses was standing on the mountain with his hands lifted, as long as his hands stayed in the air, and when Aaron and Hur ran up the hill to hold up Moses' hands, Josh didn't run up the hill to hold up his hands. Joshua knew his place. His place was to be there in the valley fighting. He said, I know as long as they keep Moses' hands up, that my hands can stay engaged.
Yes.
He stayed engaged in the battle. Why? Because he knew that he was not on the mountain. He was not the leader. He was not in that position. Himself. He said, I'm going to serve here in sincerity and truth in the battle, in the valley. But there came a time that Moses passed, and Moses said to Joshua, it's time for you to step up, be strong, and have a good courage. And Moses told him that, but then the Lord spoke to Joshua and said, Moses is dead. Now it's your time not to be in the valley, but to stand on the mountain. It's not your time to be engaged sincerely there, but it's your time to lead the people wherever God has us at. Joshua down in the battle fighting, or you've been promoted to the mountaintop to be the leader. Serve Him in sincerity and in truth.
Yes. Yes.
Joshua says, listen, I did my service. I told them the first time we saw the promised land that it was ours to possess, but they didn't want it. Majority said no. So here we dwell. He said, but all these years later, we've entered into the promised land. I'm about to check out. Serve the Lord in sincerity and truth, and put away the gods which your fathers will serve on the other side of the world. That's my message every week. Serve God. Live for God. But there is another part of that. Verse 15. If it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, the gods of the Amorite, in whose land you dwell. We all have a choice this morning. Joshua brought those folks to a crossroad. And I believe the Lord is bringing us to a crossroad this morning that we have to make a sincere choice this morning. Which will I serve? Not which will I profess or proclaim or say, but which will I live out? Carnal life or spiritual life? A life after the flesh or a life after the Spirit? The life after what I want, or life after thy will be done. He said, you've got to make a choice. As you stand with me this morning, it's your choice. Which do you want? But let me say with Joshua this morning, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And that right says, great.
Amen.
Ain't that right, Noah? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And if Gracie was over here, she'd say, we will serve the Lord. I guarantee you, Middleburg Church of God, I'm going to serve as pastor with all that is within me. my role, my calling, my position. I'm going to serve in sincerity. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. I made that decision. It's an everyday decision I have to make to serve in sincerity. You know what I'm going to decide when I get up in the morning? I'm going to serve the Middleburg Church of God as pastor in sincerity. I'm going to serve in my role as husband in sincerity, my role as a dad in sincerity, and every other title and name and role that I have in sincerity after the things of the Spirit. But it's not about my decision this morning. I made my decision. I made my choice. It's up to you. What's your role within the church? What is your role within your home? What is your role within your community as a Christian? Are you willing to do it with all sincerity and all truth? Which way have you chose? You say, well, I want Jesus. I want to live after His will and His way, but I find myself following the flesh more times than not. His grace is sufficient for you this morning. He's brought this message for you this morning to bring you to a place that you can say, give me Jesus. Take this whole world and give me Jesus. As I pray and they begin to sing, this altar is open to you today to say, I want to make a choice to surrender myself completely to Him. Maybe it's a new decision. Maybe it's a first-time decision. Or maybe it's a rededication. Or maybe it's just a soul searching. Whatever it may be, will you make your way to this altar? Father, I've delivered my heart this morning. Left them with a choice today. Flesh and spirit, we all have to choose. And I pray that they choose the spirit. Life and death, I pray that they choose life. But I pray, God, that each individual will find their place in the kingdom of God and serve in sincerity and in truth. Right now, Jesus.
Oh,